Good morning. It's good to have you all here with us this morning. Welcome to those who are joining us online. It's amazing what can happen in a week. Isn't that true? Today being Palm Sunday, they were yelling, Hosanna, Hosanna. A few days later, they're yelling, crucify him, crucify him. On that Friday. And then on that Sunday, everything changed. He arose. And today we serve a living Savior. So that is awesome. So it's good to have you all here this morning. Your announcements are in your bulletin. They are also on the screen, but I just want to highlight this coming weekend. Friday at 10 a.m., a Good Friday service. We'll be meeting at Main Street Baptist Church and having a service with them. I would encourage each and every one of us to make plans to come. It's going to be a great time together, and I'll be having the message on that day. And then Sunday, next Sunday, Lord willing, at 9 a.m., we'll be having our sunrise breakfast. Everyone is invited. If you plan on coming, please sign the list that's out in the foyer. And I believe there's some food items still needed. You can check the list as well. And or talk to Sandra and she can guide you. And then at 10:30, notice the time, next Sunday morning, 10:30 will be our morning service, and there will be no service in the evening. So our prayer focus is always there, so keep these folks in prayer and other folks that you know that need prayer. That is very important that we are a praying church, right? So that's all the announcements. So I'm going to invite you to stand as we sing 296, Hosanna, 296. Seated if you like.
And to become the Lamb.
John said, as he seen Jesus coming, "Behold, the Lamb of God, which takes away the sins of the world." We have much to be praying for. We have much to be thankful for. Isn't that true? And just an update on Tim. Tim is back to his normal self, as normal as that can be. His head injury has recovered. He goes back to work tomorrow, so there's no more headaches. He remembers everything now, so he said thank you for praying for him, and he appreciated that. It's good to have Barb with us this morning, sitting over there with hip and back issues and everything else. Continue to pray for Gail Mills with her back, and I believe Patty is home now, if I'm not mistaken. So continue to pray for Patty and Linda and all the others that are on our list here. So let's go before the throne of grace in prayer, shall we? Father in heaven, again, we do thank you and praise you for being a loving, awesome God. And Lord, what a privilege it is to be able to say, "Our Father." You are our Father. You are our personal Father. And Lord, we are here just to honor you and thank you for everything you do for us. You have blessed us, you have provided for us, you have protected us, and you have done so many things that we probably aren't even aware of. And Lord, for these things and all things, we want to say thank you. We thank you that we could be here this morning to remember, but also to celebrate what the Lord Jesus, your only begotten Son, has done for us. Thank you for sending him here. Thank you for the love that you have for us. And you prove that love by sending Jesus to come to die in our place for our sin on that cruel cross of Calvary. But we thank you that that was not the end, that Jesus was put in the tomb. 3 days later, he arose victoriously, just like he said. And now he is ascended to heaven, interceding on our behalf, preparing a place for us where we will spend all eternity with him. And what a day that will be, when we see Jesus face to face. And it reminds me of something I seen this week. Someone posted a picture saying, "This is what heaven will be like when we get there." And it's everyone hugging friends and family. And I just had to comment and say, that's not what's going to happen when we first get to heaven. We're going to fall flat on our face and worship and thank and praise Jesus for what he has done for us. So we just give you the honor, the praise for everything. For your forgiveness, for your grace, your mercy, your love. But we also praise you because you are holy, you're just, you're God of wrath, and you hate sin. And you gave a remedy for that sin, which is Jesus. We thank you for answered prayer. Lord, you have answered prayer, everyone that we ever made. Sometimes you say yes, sometimes you tell us to wait, sometimes you say no because there's something better. And we just praise you for that. And Lord, we thank you that Tim is feeling better. Lord, we thank you that Barb is here this morning, that Patty is home. We thank you that Gail's back is getting better. We thank you that Deanie is here with us this morning as well. Lord, we've been praying for these folks, and you have been working. Lord, we thank you for Jim's hand healing up. Thank you for his eyes and the results that are going on there. And Lord, we could just continue all morning praising you. And Lord, we just want to say thank you. But there are others who need to be prayed for. We think of our friends and family at the Drew. Lord, we just pray for them, that you would encourage them, that you would provide for them, you would keep them healthy and strong and free from accidents. Lord, we thank you for the staff that are there, for the great care that they give. And they honestly care for the residents that are there, and we praise you for that. We think of other nursing homes in our area, Lord, just show yourself to them and be with those folks as well. And Lord, we think of churches again looking for pastors. There are many. It seems like the list is getting longer and longer every week. We just pray that you would be, just provide men of God to stand in these pulpits who would faithfully proclaim the word, who would minister with and to the congregation that you call them to. Lord, I especially think of Wood Point today. Just be with them. We do thank you for Pastor Mills filling in the gap, Lord, as he faithfully serves them. But Lord, we do pray that you would bring a man and maybe his family there that could help grow the church, that could minister to the community and be an encouragement to the folks there. And we pray this for all the other churches looking for pastors as well. And Lord, we think of those who are ill. I know there's flus going around and COVID going around. Lord, just heal them. Restore them to their physical health so they can get back doing the things they enjoy and the things they need to do. And Lord, we also pray that you would keep us from being ill with these different illnesses, that you would watch over us and that you would protect us, but we would also be careful as well. And Lord, I do pray for our town food bank. Lord, there are many, many people who are using it now. And Lord, we just pray that you would just continue to bless the food bank in town, that we as your people here would be able to help them out a bit as we are collecting items for the next couple of weeks. And Lord, just help us to be an encouragement to them and to the folks that are in our area. So Father, as we worship you, as we praise you, please accept our praise. You tell us in your word, as long as we have breath, that we need to praise the Lord, and that's what we want to do. So just be with us, guide us, and direct us the remainder of this service, I ask. In Jesus' name, amen. You are sitting, so just look to your left, look to your right, say hi, good to see everyone. If you're online, let us know where you're from. We are going to stand and sing number 330. Are you washed in the blood? Number 330. Are you washed? We're here to celebrate what the Lord Jesus Christ has done for us. I love singing hymns like that because it asks us a lot of questions that we have to answer. And the first question is, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Because being washed in the blood of the Lamb changes everything, right? It changes everything. It transforms us from within, the blood of the Lamb. And there is power in the blood of the Lamb. We'll be singing about that in a few minutes. But there's power in the blood. No matter what people say, there's power in the blood of the Lamb. I was talking to someone the other day, and they asked me about some different popular speakers and stuff like that. And I've said this before, and you guys know this. I don't listen to too many of the popular preachers of the day. I listen to a lot of local guys that I know, and I'm encouraged by listening to them preach and everything each week. And the fellow I was talking to, he said, well, what about this guy? And I said, well, this guy has some good points and not so many good points. But I'll tell you one thing. He doesn't believe that there's power in the blood. So if he doesn't believe that there's power in the blood, I would be very cautious to listening to him and what he has to say. Because without the blood, we're not saved. Right? Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission. There's no forgiveness. So there has to be power in the blood. And that hymn says, soul cleansing power of the Lamb. Right? The Lamb that was slain. The Lamb that we celebrate, especially during Easter time. We celebrate the Lamb more than that, of course. But we focus on the Lamb during Easter. Let's not focus on the rabbit. Because that rabbit can't do a thing for you. Right? That chocolate rabbit, as good as they are, all they can do is increase your waistline. They cannot take away your sin. They can't do anything. It's not about the rabbit. It's about the Lamb. It's about the Lamb. We were in Walmart the other day, and it was like Christmas. Card after card after card, full and overflowing. Then we made the mistake of going to Costco. I don't know if you've ever been there. Most of you probably have. You know where the checkouts are. The line was all the ways down the aisle to where the toilet paper is, around the back of the store, and up the other way to the pharmacy. And I remember a lady telling me one day, if you're going to the self-checkout, you don't have to stand in line. So I snuck through the back aisle and up to the line. But he looks at me. Line starts back there. I'm like, oh, okay. But anyway, I don't know where I was going. Oh, yeah, Easter. Everyone celebrates Easter like it's a big thing. We lose what Easter is all about. It's not about gifts and presents and chocolate. It's about the Lord who left the splendors of heaven, came to this sin-cursed earth to live here, to die here, to shed his blood, to be put into that tomb, and to walk out of that tomb. That's awesome. That's awesome, isn't it? That's why we're here today. And we celebrate not in doom and gloom, like, oh, our Savior died. We celebrate, yay, our Savior died. But the grave cannot hold him. Nothing could hold him. Satan thought he won. That was a short victory. He's alive. And we're here today to remember exactly what Jesus Christ went through for us on that cross. And after we celebrate with these elements and things, we're going to look into another saying of the Lord Jesus Christ. But remember, we're here taking these elements, which are just symbols of the Lord's broken body and his blood that was shed. It is not the literal body and blood of Jesus. Well, how do you know? Because the Bible tells me that he died once and once for all, never to do it again because it was sufficient. He is the propitiation, or he is the mercy seat. And he never has to do it again because it appeased God. It satisfied God, the wrath of God. And we have put our faith and trust in him. So we come together and we remember and celebrate what he has done. If you're not a believer here this morning, and I trust each one is, but if you're not, I encourage you just to observe what we do. Because this is very serious. And we're going to look in 1 Corinthians to see how serious it is. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, it says this, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed," which we will look at tonight, by the way, "took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, when he had supped, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death," wonderful three words, "till he comes." He's coming back. He's coming back, and maybe sooner than we think, "till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep," or many have died. So we are to take this very seriously. You know, at one point, we were all unworthy. In ourselves, we are still unworthy. But in Christ, that changes everything. Changes everything. And here Paul says, "I received this from the Lord." And the Lord is saying this. So he says, let's examine ourselves. And that's what we're going to do. We're going to take a few moments just to examine ourselves. If there's any sin in our life, let's deal with it. Right? Confess it to the Lord. If there's something between you and another brother or sister in the Christ, tell the Lord, "Lord, I'm asking your forgiveness, but I'm also asking you to give me opportunity today to get things right with my brother and sister in Christ." And I would even encourage you this. If you need to do it, get up from your seat and go see wherever that brother and sister is and make amends. That's what we're told to do. So examine ourselves. Maybe you're here or you're listening online and you don't know Jesus as your Savior. Take the next few minutes and just trust in him. Receive him as your Lord and your Savior. He died for you. He died for your sin. And only through his death, burial, and resurrection can you have forgiveness of that sin. He wants to forgive you. And he says, simply believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Simply say to him, "I believe everything the Bible says about you. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died for my sin. I believe that I'm a sinner and I need to be saved. Save me." And guess what? He will. Right then and there. Or maybe just take the next few minutes and just praise God for who he is and what he's doing in your life. So let's take a few moments. We'll just examine ourselves. And then I'll ask our brother, Malcolm, to give thanks for the Lord's broken body.
bleeding and sore. Lord, when we look at the price that was paid, we look at the reason that was paid, we look at the purpose that was paid, Lord, we too should feel broken and hurt because we took that which was perfect and lovely and precious and once given, and look what has been accomplished. As the pastor said, there is power in the blood. Power in the purpose of a body that was broken and bruised for us. Because he took that which we could not. So thank you, Father God, for this time here this morning of quiet reflection and understanding of how great thou art and what you have done for us individually as a whole. In your Son's holy and precious name, we say thank you for this broken body this morning.
When he had given thanks, he broke the bread and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. Let's eat together in remembrance of him." I'm going to ask our brother David to give thanks for the Lord's shed blood.
Father God, we just want to thank you for the opportunity to be here this morning and to celebrate together the death of Christ. And Father, we thank you that Jesus came to earth. We thank you that he went to the cross. Thank you that he stayed on the cross. Thank you that he shed his blood, that he was buried, was victorious over the grave. And we just thank you that he is back in. We thank you, Father, that he made a way for us to come to God. And we just praise you for that. The forgiveness of sin, we praise you for that. And we just give you our thanks today for what you have done for us. In Jesus' name. Amen.
We also read, if you took the cup, he said, "This cup is a new testament in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let's drink together. Again, Father, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for sending your only begotten Son into this sin-cursed earth to take upon himself our sin, our guilt, our shame, the just for the unjust. And we thank you that in return, we receive his righteousness. Oh, what a debt that he paid. And he paid it all. Not just a piece, not just a part, but he paid the sin debt in full. That's why he cried from the cross, "It is finished." So we praise you for that. Help us as your people to remember, to reflect, to celebrate what you have done for us each and every day of our lives, not just the first Sunday of a month. As often as you do this, remember me. So, Lord, help us to remember you each and every day. So we thank you, we praise you. And now as we collect the benevolent offering, Father, may we use it for those in our church and those in our community who are in need. So, Father, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. What it is about that hymn, but I don't think I've ever sung it until about 2 months ago. I learned it on YouTube, and then we sang it here, and why does he love us so? Right? What a wonderful, wonderful hymn, and I encourage you to take your hymn book and read those words occasionally, and just like, why does he love me so? And aren't you thankful that he does love us? He loves us for sure. If you have your Bibles, turn with me for the next few moments to John chapter 19. John chapter 19. And during the approximately 6 hours that Jesus hung on the cross, our Lord spoke 7 final statements. And that's what we have been looking at over the last several months, the 7 statements that Jesus cried on the cross. And one of these statements is recorded here in John chapter 19, verse 28. And it says this: "After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, saith, I thirst." Have you ever wondered why he would say, "I thirst"? That's a good question to ponder. Why did Jesus say, "I thirst"? He just could have went right on to the next statement and said, "It is finished," and then gave up the ghost. But why is this phrase, "I thirst," cried from the cross? One, the Apostle John tells us that Jesus' statement, "I thirst," was to fulfill Scripture. To fulfill Scripture. We see that right in our verse. Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that the Scripture might be fulfilled, said, "I thirst." There were, in fact, over 20 prophecies, Old Testament prophecies that were fulfilled in that 24-hour period of Jesus' death. Can you imagine 20 prophecies fulfilled in a 24-hour period? And by highlighting how Old Testament scripture was fulfilled throughout Jesus' crucifixion, John was saying this: everything that took place in that 24-hour period and the days before was part of God's plan. God didn't make it up on the fly. It was all part of God's plan. That way they could say, therefore they could say, Scripture was fulfilled. God's plan was being fulfilled before their very eyes. When Jesus said, I thirst from the cross, he was alluding to a prophecy. Turn back to the book of Psalm. Psalm 22, verse 15. We looked at Psalm 22 the last time we were looking into a statement of Jesus. But here in Psalm 22, verse 15, this is what Jesus was alluding to. He said, my strength is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue cleaveth to my jaws, and thou hast brought me into the dust of death. Here's what Jesus was saying. My mouth is dry. My tongue is stuck to the roof of my mouth. I thirst. I'm thirsty. And then he says, you lay me in the dust of death. The Apostle John cited from Psalm 22 earlier when it came to the dividing of Jesus' garments back in verse 23 of John 19. But in response to Jesus' statement, I thirst, he's requesting a drink. The soldiers offered him wine vinegar. Look at verse 29 of John 19. Jesus said, I thirst. Now there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put it upon hyssop and put it to his mouth. They gave him something to drink. Wine vinegar. Wine vinegar apparently was the cheapest wine that a soldier can find. And I'm sure they probably even diluted it with water so that it could go further. Earlier, Jesus refused to drink. You remember? He refused to drink. They offered him vinegar, gall, and myrrh to relieve his suffering. But he refused to drink it at that point. Matthew 27. Matthew 27, verse 34. Listen to what it says. Matthew 27, 34. They gave him vinegar to drink, mingled with gall. And when he had tasted thereof, he would not drink. He would not drink. We see Mark 15 tells us the same thing. He would not drink because what they offered him was a painkiller. And he didn't want to give up any of the pain. So he refused to drink. After that, in Luke 23, verse 36, we see that the soldiers mockingly offered him a drink of wine vinegar, but they didn't allow him to drink it. That was another way they taunted him. Can you imagine? He's hanging on the cross. They put this vinegar wine and right up to his mouth. And then they pulled it back. They maybe put it back up again and pulled it back. You know, we do that with our kids sometimes, don't we, when we tease them? You want it? Come and get it. Come and get it. They get real close and we pull it away. But that's what they were doing. They were mocking Jesus. But here, several hours later, Jesus states, "I thirst." He states, "I am thirsty," asking for a drink. This time, the soldier gave him a drink. And that was a fulfillment of prophecy. In Psalm 69, verse 21 or 22, I believe it's 21. This action was a fulfillment. So why did Jesus tell them he was thirsty? I believe this is the reason. His mouth was dry. Ever have a dry mouth and try to talk? Ever have a dry mouth and try to yell? Jesus says, "I thirst," because he had something very important to say. And he wanted everyone to hear it. He wanted the world to hear it. They gave him a drink. And then it tells us right after that in verse 30, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "It is finished." I believe that's why he said, "I'm thirsty. Give me a drink, because I don't want anybody to miss this." Wouldn't it make a bigger impact? Or which would make a bigger impact? Barb, you tell me when I'm finished. I'll pick on you, okay? Would it have a bigger impact if you heard me say, or would it be a bigger impact if you heard me say, "It is finished"? That one. The second one. So Jesus said, "Hey, I thirst because I got a message that the whole world has to hear. So give me a drink." They gave him a drink, and then he declared his final statement, "It is finished. It's paid in full." Or in other words, "I love you all. It's done." He didn't say, "I'm finished. I can't endure anymore." No. "It is finished." Hanging on that cross, Jesus suffered bitter agony. Bitter agony. He suffered darkness. He suffered these things while having our guilt, our shame, and our sin upon him. He suffered these things. When the act of purchasing our redemption was complete, nothing more was needed. Therefore, he cried, "It is finished. Everything that I have come to earth to accomplish is done." Isn't that awesome? It's done. The scriptures were fulfilled. Christ's work was done. The battle was over. The victory was won. Amen, Pastor. I'm going to have to get a card up here and just stick it up once in a while. But the victory was won. All that God had purposed and all that the prophets had foretold was complete. And Jesus surrendered himself to death. It was finished. From the Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke, we learn that Jesus died and he cried with a loud voice. Luke reports, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And having said thus, he gave up the ghost. So Jesus said, "I thirst," because he had a message that he needed everyone to hear. He moistened his throat. He moistened his lips to utter one final victorious shout before he died. It is finished. Guess what? It is finished is a statement we're going to look at next time. That's not the statement today. The statement today is, I thirst. But I thirst leads to the next two statements, which are very important and very powerful. The death of Jesus Christ finished his work of redemption. It finished his work of atonement. It finished his work of reconciliation. Through Christ's sacrificial death, his substitutionary death on the cross, the Lamb of God paid our debt and took our sin away. Our debt is paid in full. Our ransom is complete. Isn't that awesome? It's complete. Jesus, with that resounding voice, wanted all people to hear those words. Traditionally, and I'll finish with this, traditionally, these words from the cross mean certain things. You remember Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Traditionally, that refers to forgiveness. That's what the cross was all about. Then we see salvation. When he said to the thief on the cross, today you will be with me in paradise. Salvation. We see relationship in the crucifixion, don't we? Woman, behold thy son. And then son, behold thy mother. We also seen abandonment. My God, why have you forsaken me? And today in the phrase, I thirst, we see distress. I thirst. Give me something to drink because I have something to say. And I want everyone to hear it. And we still hear it today, don't we? It is finished. Father in heaven, again, we just thank you and praise you for who you are. And we thank you when the Lord Jesus was on the cross that he cried out, I thirst. I thirst, because he had a special message for us all to hear. And that message was, it is finished. He wanted the whole world to hear that. It is finished. Paid in full. We thank you so much for what he went through on that cross. Thank you that he was obedient even unto death. So Lord, help us to remember these things. Help us to remember the reasons why Jesus said what he said. Forgiveness, salvation, relationship, abandonment, and distress. But Lord willing, next time we are together, we will look at that phrase again, it is finished, and what we will see is triumph. Triumph over sin, death, and Satan. Thank you for being our Savior and our Lord. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and sing our closing hymn, There is Power in the Blood, 329.
free from your passion and pride. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. We own to a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you be wider, much wider than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains our loss in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Amen. Before we leave, I want to do that chorus again. So, dear, if you can go back to that chorus. When we used to sing it, we would say, there's love, joy, peace, power, wonder-working power. Okay? So let's try that. If you don't want to try those words, you can still sing power, power, wonder-working power. So there's love, joy, peace, power, wonder-working power. Okay? There is love, joy, peace, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is love, joy, peace, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Amen. God bless you, folks. Lord willing, we'll see you tonight.